My name is Devin McCourty. It's an honor and pleasure to be here to speak to everyone. As members of the community and Patriot players, we feel deeply indebted to our society and our supporters. We have visited dozens of schools in Massachusetts, schools that are thriving, and obviously some schools that are struggling. Therefore, we know the Promise Act will make a huge impact in students. These young people have inspired us in our day-to-day lives. We know that they are the future of our region, our nation, and the world. And we are confident that if we give them everything, they can achieve amazing things. Today, we are here because in 2017, NFL players came together to form an independent 501c3 and 501c4 nonprofit organization called the Players Coalition to impact racial and social inequalities. Our focus areas have been education and economic advancement, criminal justice reform, and police and community relations. The coalition is made up of more than 12 members, both current and former players, and more than 100 members league-wide. We focus on educating ourselves in the subject matter, and then obviously uplifting the voice of people who just don't get the opportunity. Last year, members of the Players Coalition, including myself, Matthew Slater, Duron Harmon, and Jason McCourty, strongly advocated for passage of the Foundation Budget Review Commission recommendation for the education bill. We were disappointed when legislators could not reach an agreement and resolve the issues. And we thought that additional funding would be great for the schools and help bring equality towards all Massachusetts schools. As NFL players, and obviously as Patriot players, we know it's impossible to achieve great success without support and resources. This is why public schools are funded, and that's why they provide additional support to the populations that require it. We wrote out a compelling argument in a hot-day and correspondence to many of you facts that we learned from subject matter experts, teachers, and community advocates. In Massachusetts, we rank number one by U.S. News and World Report for Education, yet 70% of Black and Latino third graders read below that grade level average, according to stand.org. I obviously don't want to sit here and tell you a bunch of stats that obviously everyone knows in the room, but we all know how important a reading skill is to taking in life. Reading kind of predicates the future educational success you will have and give children a chance to go off in the world and make a huge impact and have a bright future. Failing these kids will be failing ourselves and our country. We know that we are competing with budgetary priorities for all publicly funded entities, but we are prepared to battle for our children. So we thank you for listening to us. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Good morning, committee members. My name is Jason McCourty, and like Devin said, I'm very honored and humbled to be here in front of you guys. Last fall, we met with teachers and educational experts to get a landscape of the reality of the shortfalls. Over the last decade, school districts have been forced to make difficult cuts year after year. Classrooms across the state have lost critical services and programs such as social and emotional supporters like counselors, wraparound services, resources like technology and books, professional development, and even preschool programs. On top of these cuts, Massachusetts has one of the worst achievement gaps in the United States, as many have said. Consider the following. In Massachusetts, 31% of Black and 38% of Latino children live in poverty. Nearly 25% of Black children and 30% of Latino kids live in communities of concentrated poverty. It follows that these under-resourced communities have more underperforming schools, fewer economic opportunities, and obviously a higher rate of crime. And speaking with teachers in these lower-income schools with a larger minority student base, they don't have the necessary resources or counselors or even books to provide the same level of education as the affluent, predominantly white schools. Teachers share that often they have to write their own curriculum as they are not provided one. If a teacher isn't provided with the curriculum, how can we expect their students to live up to the standard that is being enforced statewide? As we sat down and spoke to some of these teachers and reflected on our own school days, it was astonishing to hear that some students could be stuck with a part-time science teacher, or students even wouldn't have a physical education teacher, and our program could be completely cut. Through my own experience, a lot of times it was those teachers where students were able to make the strongest connection. The classrooms that allow students to have a release or an opportunity to fully express themselves without judgment. We must invest in our students and our future. We cannot pour into and mold our youth as if they're a little league football team and expecting to compete at a Super Bowl level. Right now, our teachers do not have enough money to serve our minority students or live
discipline as compared to 127, or roughly 3.7% for white children. The presence of police in schools also increases the likelihood that school-based offenses result in worse. Black and Latino students make up a percentage of those school-based arrests. Using scarce public education money to deploy police in schools makes the racial disparities worse without making schools safer. Our school needs more sources, but those sources should not come in the form of police. We have to take into consideration that every child that comes to school has a different background. We have students who are dealing with neglect at home, violence at home, violence in their communities, students who only eat when they come to school. All these different situations can make a student act a particular way. These things need to be taken into consideration when we are disciplining the students. Being arrested, suspended, is not always the answer. Is it the easiest? Yes, but the easiest way is not always the best way. Teachers and students alike will be better served by resources that support and train clinical staff to deal with disciplinary matters and related concerns. Professional development, reading programs, counseling, psychological services, athletics, physical education, and other student support services or programs. With the Education Promise Act, it is designed to fix funding glitches and prevent failures in inequity. It corrects current undercounting of poverty by providing districts with the option to manually count their low-income students rather than rely on flawed data matching. Additionally, we ensure that all students in district public schools receive their promised aid from the state after accounting for charter tuition factors. Also ensures low income, health care, and minimum and provisions that are all implemented at the same pace, so no district gets left behind. The Promise Act is the only bill that implements all five of the FBRC recommendations, and it is the only bill that will do right by poor kids and kids of color. This will impact the youth from the urban areas beyond measure, and it is up to us to make sure we see it. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, Madam Chair, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. My name is Matthew Slater. On behalf of my peers and myself, we would like to thank you for taking the time to listen to our testimonies today. We've come here today because of the personal values we all dearly cling to. As Mr. McCourty mentioned earlier, we all feel as though we have been gifted with a tremendous and unique platform as professional athletes. We believe that platform allows us to lend our voices to causes and people that don't always have the opportunity to have their own voices heard. Our hope today has been to lend our voices to thousands of children, in particular impoverished children of color, who need all of our help. The reality is that no child gets to choose their family of origin, their race, the language spoken within their home, what learning limitations they may have, or their socioeconomic background. In turn, they don't have a choice in what type of education they will receive. It is our belief that we should do everything within our power to give every child the opportunity to have the same learning experience within our educational system. As you all know, the bipartisan FBRC found that Massachusetts is underestimating the cost of education. As members of the Players Coalition, concerned citizens, and as fathers, we are invested in ensuring education equity for all students in Massachusetts. Educating our children now means having an educated workforce in the future, which is one of our state's best economic assets. Because of the comprehensive nature of the Promise Act, it gives young people a better chance to grow up so that they can contribute to their communities, improving our future state economy and helping prevent intergenerational poverty. We thank you for your time today, and it's our hope that you will consider not only our testimonies, but all the testimonies you've heard today. Thank you very much.